Hi, I'm Laura, and this is tropetrinitytrilogy, and today I'll be reviewing The Ivies by Alexa Donne. So I received a free ARC of this book in exchange for an honest review. Now, I received a digital ARC on NetGalley, and I was supposed to get a physical copy by now. However, I think the post office is having issues with it because the post office is very good at losing my stuff. I have not received a physical copy yet, but that's okay because I received a digital copy way ahead of time. I read it and I have my thoughts compiled to review to you. And if I do get the physical copy, I will be posting a bunch of pretty pictures of it on my Instagram, so I'll link that below in case you want to check out my pretty book pics and want to see the Ivies pics when I get it, if it's not lost forever. Oh god. Also though, before I get into the review, I want to let you know there is a giveaway for one free copy that any US can win of The Ivies. And I will link down the information below. You have to enter by May 30th and the giveaway ends at 12 a.m. Central Standard Time, May 30th. So you better get into that description, get the link, and sign up if you want to win a free copy of this book. Anyway though, let's get right into the review. All the thoughts and comments I have are my honest ones, and the fact that I got a free copy will have no effect on that. So what is The Ivies about? Let me read you the blurb. Everyone knows The Ivies, the most coveted universities in the United States. Far more important are the Ivies. The Ivies at Claflin Academy, that is. Five girls with the same mission, to get into the Ivy League by any means necessary. I would know, I'm one of them. We disrupt class ranks, club leaderships, and academic competitions, among other things. We improve our own odds by decreasing the fortune of others, because hyper elite competitive college admissions is serious business, and in some cases, it's deadly. Alexa Donne delivers a nail-biting and timely thriller about teens who will stop at nothing to get into the college of their dreams. Too bad no one told them murder isn't an extracurricular. Too bad no one told them murder isn't an extracurricular. So I would say this blurb is very accurate, except for one thing. This book felt more like a mystery than a thriller to me. And I haven't read that many book thrillers. I've read book mysteries, but I have watched both of them. So maybe this has more to do with the fact that what's a thriller in a movie is not the same as what's a thriller in the book. But for me, an example of what a thriller is would be the movie The Fugitive, where there is a mystery to solve. I'm not sure every thriller needs a mystery, but in that case, there is a mystery to solve who killed the main character's wife. But he was also accused and arrested for her murder and being sent to prison. And then he escapes and is on the run while he's trying to hunt down his wife's killer. So it's constant action and survival. Whereas for a mystery, a good televised example of that for me would be the TV show Castle, where there's always a murder and they're trying to solve it. And yes, there are chase scenes, there's scenes where the main characters are almost killed even. However, those are just some of the scenes within the greater show, which focuses more on the mystery, talking to suspects, investigating evidence, and that sort of thing. So to me, The Ivies has more of that mystery vibe than thriller vibe. Now, based on the rest of the blurb, I kind of got the impression it would be more mystery. So the book did deliver what I expected. However, what I would assume based on the genre is that this is more a mystery to me. So if you're wondering what this book's vibe will be to you, it's more of the trying to solve the murder without a constant danger or people trying to kill the protagonist. There are some scenes that are pretty tense and exciting with some action, but definitely not enough for me to consider it a thriller. However, this has no effect on my personal rating because I actually kind of expected it to be more of a mystery, but I thought I would let you know because my reviews are trying to give you as much information as possible to decide what you want. So now let's get into my main points about the actual book and not just the advertising. Number one, the writing style is a basic YA writing style. This book is definitely young adult, and you can tell that from how it is written. The writing style is straightforward, simple, and sometimes uses that casual teen way of speaking. It doesn't use an excessive amount of slang, but it does sometimes feel a bit teenish, which, since this is first-person point of view from a teen's perspective, kind of makes sense. You would expect it to have that vibe to it. However, one touch I thought was really nice with the writing style was that there was a lot of large words used in this story, and it was relevant because the protagonist was a super nerd trying to get an Ivy League. So they were SAT words the character would have had to learn. And of course she wants to use them in telling her story because she worked hard to learn them for the SATs, and gosh dang it, she's going to use them. It didn't say that verbatim, but that's how I interpret it, and I think that's kind of funny. I will say with the narration, I never had any issues with it. It was straightforward teen speak with a couple big words. However, I will say the dialogue, when I first started reading it, did take me aback a bit, and I thought some of it was a bit not my favorite. However, I've been reading mostly classics recently, and the longer I read the book and the further I got, after the first chapter, I never had any issues with the dialogue. So I think it's something that you grow accustomed to. And if you already read YA, it probably would be very natural for you to read. I was just reading a lot of classics, and sometimes you need a moment to adjust. But I thought I'd let you know, because if you're not super into teen dialogue, there is teen dialogue. And one other critique I have with the writing is that the prologue felt unnecessary. It was extremely short, and it didn't spoil anything like that. It just, you could have cut it, not changed a single thing, the story still would have worked. And honestly, I think the first chapter had a good punchy beginning, and the prologue was completely unnecessary. I don't think it took away from the reading experience, but I also don't know why it was there. Also, I want to talk about one thing I really liked in the writing. It's one sentence, but I like it. And it's that, and that is that the book uses the word turtle as a verb. This is the quote, "I turtle into my fluffy down coat." And for me, that gives me such a clear image of the character doing this in her coat to keep warm. And I think it's really cute, because turtles are cute and the whole image is adorable. And also, I think it's fun when writers play with language in that way. And it's sometimes fun to use nouns as verbs. Now, it doesn't always work, but I think it's cool. And the only other example I could think of is Shakespeare. And he actually created the word assassinate from the word assassin, because assassin was a thing, but not assassinate. And he's like, why don't I just make the actual career, for lack of a better word, the person who does it have a verb directly of what they're doing. So I think that's cool. And I don't think this is going to take off the same way, but I think it's cute to use the word turtle as a verb for like snuggling in your clothes and protecting yourself like a little turtle. So I just wanted to point that out because I like that creative use of writing and I thought it was good imagery. And I like turtles. It's important. So overall, the writing was average YA, and I think it did a good job giving the protagonist a little bit of an original voice. Not a crazy original or unique voice. I don't think it was the greatest voice ever, but I thought it fit her character well, and I could read it, and the writing could go into the background for me, and I could enjoy the story. That's the type of writing this book has. Writing that you can just use as the vessel for the story, not necessarily writing that sticks out in a good or bad way, except the word turtle as a verb. That stood out to me. So if you like YA and its writing, or at least are fine with the writing of YA, this book will be fine for you. But if you hate YA and its writing, then this isn't for you. It's first person from a teen's perspective. It's to be expected. So this isn't the book that if you hate YA is going to change that for you. Now let's get to point number two. The protagonist is morally gray, and I really like that. I really like a good morally gray protagonist, and for me personally, this book pulls it off. And I want to discuss why I think this. So this book is first person perspective, which I think is probably the hardest perspective to write a good morally gray protagonist, because of course the person narrating the whole thing is biased towards themselves. If the protagonist calls out their flaws too much, then it's weird and it kind of feels arbitrary, like why would they keep doing this if they think it's so terrible, or the protagonist completely ignores their flaws and they're so biased that it just seems like the book is portraying them as morally good and doesn't even acknowledge their flaws. And then when I read something like that, instead of perceiving it as a complex character study being done by the author, I perceive it as poor writing. And honestly, when I first started reading the book, I found Olivia and in turn the writing to be kind of annoying. Olivia is very biased towards herself and she tries to justify her actions a lot. And at first I thought the book was trying to justify them. However, as I kept reading, I realized, no, this is Olivia's biased perspective, and the world around Olivia made it clear that she wasn't the center of the universe. And I think that's the most important thing with writing a good protagonist. They have to feel like someone living in there who people would judge the same as they would any other character for their actions. And by making all the other characters and the outside forces in the plot not centered around Olivia or giving her extra excuses or second chances compared to anyone else, I think this allowed Olivia to be a good morally gray protagonist, because yes, she was biased towards herself, but the world was not biased towards her. Because at first it seemed like Olivia kept trying to justify her actions as not as bad as others, or she wasn't as bad because she was poor and they're mean rich people. But then you keep reading and she gets called out and different things happen to her that kind of suck, but the world doesn't just make it all go away and make it all better. So I think Olivia is a well-done, morally gray protagonist. And I think this goes to show you need to finish a book before you judge it, because I was annoyed at Olivia. I felt the book was excusing her and supporting her. And then I keep reading, I'm like, no, that's not the case. And I think authors should be allowed to irritate you or annoy you with their writing before they get to the end, because that can result in a stronger story. And I think in some ways, by being in Olivia's head for so long, when the stuff that I was kind of frustrated about finally came to fruition, it was so much more impactful and exciting to get to that point. Also, I like how Olivia is a bit of a bigger girl. She's tall, and I kind of imagined her as being kind of broad shoulders, maybe broad hips, you know, not super petite, big girl who does crew and is probably relatively buff. But I thought it was cool having a bit more of a sturdy girl. And I think one of the reasons why I appreciate Olivia so much is she doesn't feel special. Now, she's good at the things she tries to do when she works hard at them, but I never got the feeling that she was a chosen one or a special snowflake or anything like that. She's just a character in this world who doesn't always get what she wants and has consequences for her actions, and even some consequences for things that aren't even her actions. But she feels like a real person, an average person that a reader could relate to. However, despite the fact of her not being special, I also think she was a good choice in the protagonist. I'm not saying it like, oh yeah, she's any other side character could be swapped out with her, because no, she would have to be the protagonist for the story to work. I just appreciate how she was written. Also, though, I would like to add that a morally gray character doesn't need to be perfectly called out and change and become a better person for me to like them. I don't think this book does that. It doesn't have some preachy thing where it's like, Olivia, these are what's wrong with the ways you're living your life, and this is how you can fix it. And she's like, I'm gonna fix it and be a better person. It's not like that. She's a morally gray protagonist. The world treats her as such, but it's not some big lesson on how to live your life, which I think is good. I don't think you need to have some big lesson for every book you write, and I don't want to give you that impression from my description of what I like in a morally gray protagonist. So, next point. Number three, the author inserts her politics a lot. So this is the first real issue I have with this book that I'm mentioning, because a lot of the book, especially at the beginning, the author just has the character think about or characters talk about her political opinions or different political views, or even just views about people in general, to the point where it was kind of excessive. It slowed down the story and it didn't really add to the mystery aspect. I'm not saying that an author can't put in their political views, but if it's not a fictional book, strictly focused on politics or these topics, then I would prefer for it to be interwoven into the story in a more natural way instead of constantly stopping to discuss these things. And due to the constant political views being put in, I felt that it treated a lot of characters as flat. It was, this is the good characters who think this thing, and this is the bad characters who think this thing, which with a mystery, I like complex and messy characters, and I think that was simplifying it a bit. There weren't necessarily pure good characters, but there's a lot of pure bad characters, and it's like, okay, you can tell who the ones the authors dislike the most, and they're more likely to be killers because they fit XYZ traits. But also the bigger issue with the politics being put in was that it took away from the mystery and thriller aspect. I never really felt this sense of tension that I, especially a thriller, would have. And I also didn't necessarily feel like I was looking at different characters trying to solve the mystery the whole time. I was kind of just reading my way through. I didn't feel like I was participating in solving it because I was constantly stopping for the character to tell me her opinion. And some of these were revealed to be the character's personal bias, and they were called out, and it wasn't necessarily all of them, the author trying to tell you what is the correct thing. Some of them were like that. However, I think it was to the point that it took away from the mystery and made it feel more like the author wanted to tell us what she thinks. And it's not that any of these issues shouldn't have been in the story at all, because most of them were relevant to college admissions, but the amount they were in the story was more than I would have liked. Because again, I've read multiple books with authors' political positions in them, but either it's the main focus of the book and it's a thoughtful discussion, or it's not the main focus of the book, it's more of an adventure story, but it's interwoven in a way that it never breaks the flow. And I don't feel like this was the case here. And also, to be honest, a first-person YA book where you only get the protagonist's perspective on a specific political position and she's kind of just ranting her positions at you is not the book I would go to for different political discussions. Maybe that's how you like them, but I would prefer either multiple point of views, third person, maybe more adult, but that's just me personally. So let's get to point number four. The setting felt alive and added to the tension. This book takes place at a wealthy boarding school where the main character is the less wealthy person there, which is pretty typical, not anything special. You might like the trope and then you'd like the book setting by default, but for me, it's just a setting. However, some of the specifics of it I thought were pretty clever. First, this book takes place at the end of the first semester during exam season. And second, it takes place in senior year of high school when the characters would be applying to colleges. And third of all, it takes place in Massachusetts. And since it's the end of the semester, it's in December, which means it's cold and gets dark very early. So why do I think the setting is clever? Well, it's for two reasons. One, I think it supports the themes of the story. And two is because I find the setting adds to the tension. First, let's discuss how the setting supports the themes of the story. So this may be a murder mystery, but what it's really about, what the characters discuss, what really affects what they do, and what even caused the murder in the first place is competitive college admissions. So this book is school and academic focus. So it's in the most stressful time you will ever have in school, during exams and also during applying to colleges. So the characters are juggling exams and colleges, and this results in the crux of the story, the reason for everything happening, always being front and center. And also, since it's a boarding school, the characters can never find reprieve from this. They're always trapped in this academic structure. Second, this adds to the urgency of the story because the protagonist is never able to just relax or have a break. She's either trying to solve the murder, studying or taking exams, or applying to colleges. She's always having to juggle these things and doesn't get to relax, so neither does the reader. Also, the winter aspect and it being dark all the time makes it feel more dangerous, because in the dark, everything feels more dangerous because people can't see as well. And especially with it being a boarding school, when she's in her dorm room by herself, where you're pretty sure the killer could get in there, That's pretty nerve-wracking. You definitely can't feel safe in a room where you're like, yeah, I think the killer could get in here without me being able to stop him. That's really rough. So neither Olivia or the reader can ever really feel safe. Now I want to get to point number five, and that is the book is wrong about some colleges, in my opinion. So this isn't actually a flaw that I'm taking points away from, but I want to address this because that's who I am as a person. This book makes a big deal about the protagonist wanting to pursue journalism, and she's like, Harvard is the great school for journalism. It'll give me so many advantages, which Harvard's an Ivy League, so it makes sense it would give you advantages. But then she specifically says, University of Maryland, College Park, which is where she's from, Maryland, so that'd be her in-state school. She's like, that school's not that great for journalism. I don't want to go there. Which I know someone who went to College Park for journalism, and I'm pretty sure they have a pretty highly esteemed College of Journalism in College Park. College Park's Philip Merrill College of Journalism is fully accredited by the Accrediting Council on Education in Journalism and Mass Communication, which Harvard is not accredited in that. And I looked up some surveys, and according to College Factual, College Park's journalism program is ranked 8th in the country and also the second best for veterans who want to go into journalism and 12th most profitable to go into if you want to be a journalist. And Harvard didn't beat College Park on any of those lists. Then when I was looking into Harvard, it was listed as one of the top 100 colleges for journalism, but it was ranked 95 on that list and College Park was ranked 16th. So I don't know why the book insists on downplaying College Park's journalism program and then hyping up the Ivy Leagues and Harvard, because a lot of that has to do with the fact it's just an Ivy League, but that doesn't necessarily mean the program is better. So I don't know, maybe the author knows something about College Park that I don't, but it seems like their journalism program is pretty hyped up and they're pretty proud of it. So I don't, and I've heard about it being pretty good. Like one of the best journalism programs, at least in the area, and no one has said Harvard's is better. So, just saying, book. If you want to go to College Park for journalism, this book might not be the best to go to for advice. But that doesn't affect my rating. That's a little rant, though. Also, this book says a purple cow is a terrible mascot, which is objectively false. Now, let's get to actual relevant points that affect my rating. Number six, Avery is bae. So Avery is the main mean girl in this book, and I really liked how she was written. And she is my favorite character in this book, hands down, and probably one of the favorite mean girls I've ever read in a book. I dislike a lot of fictional mean girls. A lot of them are stereotypes, and they're just excessively mean for no reason. Sometimes they're just straight up evil. I'm like, this is a high school bully. Calm down, writer. Just calm down. You're writing a mean girl in high school. But Avery is actually a complex, interesting character. And yes, she is very flawed, but her flaws make sense given her backstory. And honestly, for a lot of the book, I was wanting some character to say something, a specific thing any of the characters could say. And Avery was the one to say it. So I'm just like, yes, girl, finally, someone said it. It needed to be said. And she was the one to do it. So I was like, Avery, I appreciate you. Avery is what I like in a mean girl. Instead of her being some evil character we're just supposed to hate, she's a character we're supposed to judge early on and then learn to see more clearly. I don't want to spoil anything with her character or anything in the book, but I will say again, Avery's my favorite character in the book and one of my favorite mean girls I've ever read. And I want to do a trope talk video on mean girls after reading this because I'm kind of inspired to do that. And I want to use Avery as a positive example for how to write a good mean girl. Tell me if you're interested. Number seven, the side characters were kind of meh. So Olivia, the protagonist, I liked her overall, even if she was very frustrating at the beginning. I think she was good, morally great. Avery, great mean girl, loved her. Chef's kiss. Then there was one other character, Ethan, who is a side character, who I thought was actually pretty complex and dynamic. So I liked his character. He had a good bit of layers to him. Not as exciting as Avery, but I thought he was pretty well done. However, a lot of the other side characters in the book, didn't do that much for me. Some of them felt really flat and really only had one shtick to them, whereas others might have had a bit more complexity, but I feel it went from 0 to 100. And personally, when it comes to a mystery, I need a lot of compelling and interesting characters with layers who create a presence for themselves on the page, so I, as a reader, start to try to solve the mystery. I think mysteries, murder mysteries, are really important for having a good cast of interesting and complex characters, because you need the different suspects. And this book kind of only really had one or two red herrings, and it went so hard on them that I knew they weren't it. And really, with a mystery, you need a lot of different characters that you could see being it, but with so many of the characters barely being on the page, it would be kind of anticlimactic for them to be the killer. So it's just like, yeah, you're in one scene, it's not you, that would be lame. So yeah, this book needed to work on side characters because most of them were pretty forgettable, which again, for a murder mystery, you need a lot of suspects that you genuinely are interested in. Number 8, the romantic subplot had a good conclusion. So this book's romance is kind of not something I'm super into and rooting for, but also nothing bad. It's kind of a first romance where the characters are kind of awkward, and that's the point. And it never, to me, felt like the author was trying to get me into the romance to insert myself. I didn't feel like I was supposed to be like, oh my gosh, this is my OTP, I love them so much. It didn't feel like the book was trying to make me feel the romance as much as it was just another character relationship in the book to add some complexity to how the characters interacted. However, despite the fact that I wasn't super into the romance, I really liked the conclusion of the romance at the end of the story. I thought it was interesting, it shocked me in some ways, and honestly, the characters getting to know each other and falling for each other was kind of cute in a very unobtrusive way. I liked some of the thoughts the character had about it, about being like, oh, I like that I'm really tall and big and take up space because that means I'm closer to the guy and stuff like that. I thought those were interesting perspectives and I liked it. Now, point number 9. Though I did find some of the twists in this book surprising and good, the killer's motivation was really stupid. So first I want to start with the good twist, because honestly, this book had a lot of reveals, a lot of twists and turns about what characters had done, and it's very messy and interesting and kind of got that mean girl gossipy thing going on, but not just mean girls, because it's like academic scandals going on. And I thought it was really cool. I really liked the tangled web. There's one thing that completely shocked me, and the book was doing a really good job with the twist, in my opinion, and revelations and all the crazy stuff people had done. And most of the book, and I would say once the book really started picking up a little bit before the middle, all the way to the revelation at the end, it was doing great. Most of the book was keeping my attention. Honestly, the whole book kept my attention. I was constantly reading it, couldn't put it down. I thought everything was super interesting until we got to the final reveal. I gotta be honest, I didn't like the killer's motivation. I thought it was lame. I didn't think it was that good of a reason. It's not that I predicted the killer's motivation. I definitely did not, but it was really lame and anticlimactic, and I didn't believe that anyone would be that stupid, because it's such a stupid motivation. Like, seriously? That's it? So yeah, the end to the mystery was disappointing for me, and since this is a murder mystery, that's a pretty big deal. Any of the characters could have been the killer and I would have been fine with that. What matters to me more is the motivation and it being compelling, and it just wasn't. It wasn't. Number 10, I liked the ending. Besides the reveal of the murder, everything after that, with how it was wrapped up, how I got to see what happened to the characters and the scenes, it was well done in a way that was still interesting despite the revelation having already happened. I was genuinely curious to see what was going on in the characters' lives, and it felt very real to me. It didn't feel like some perfect, neat ending where it concludes and, oh, the movie's over, everything's done. It felt like It felt messy and it felt real and it felt like it would keep going on, like in real life, because your life keeps going and it's messy and it's not always perfect. So I appreciate that. I especially like what happened with my favorite characters, Olivia, Avery, and Ethan. I will say the conclusion to Ethan's storyline was very frustrating. However, I appreciate it and I thought it, I liked it. I liked that it frustrated me because it's part of life. So overall, I would give this book 3 stars. I didn't particularly like the revelation of the murder, and I thought the politics put in it was a bit excessive. And to be honest, I wish I had been more invested in a lot of the side characters. However, I really thought this was an interesting, morally gray protagonist, and I thought it was well done how she frustrated me so much at the beginning, and then as the story continued, I felt that the story became more compelling with other characters like telling her what they finally think. And I thought it was well done. Avery's the best mean girl I've ever read. Bavery. I liked her. I thought she was complex and interesting. And honestly, I liked Avery. I was rooting for Avery. I was like, I don't care if you murder everyone, Avery. I'm on your team. Okay, not really. Not really. I just thought she was a really interesting mean girl and I liked how she was written. But I really liked Avery. And honestly, the setting was really, I liked the setting. I liked the academicness and how everyone's doing exams and applying to college and how it's really stressful. Because I think a lot of school settings is just a backdrop for kids arguing with each other. And this one's like, no, school is terrible and it will work you to death. And honestly, some of the twists did shock me throughout the book. A lot of different things happen. It's not just nothing really happening and then the revelation. There's twists and turns and reveals happening through the whole thing. And I really liked them all. I thought they were cool and shocking. And it's a very tangled web. And I appreciate that. So if you're in the mood to read a YA mystery, I would definitely recommend this book. Mostly for Avery. But it does have a lot of shocking twists and turns throughout, and I think the setting is very atmospheric. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. Have you read this book? Did you like it? If you have, do you want to read this book? Please let me know all your thoughts down below. Thank you for watching this video. Don't forget about the giveaway, and I'll see you later.